Мы рады приветствовать вас в этом институте. Собрались, чтобы отметить выдающееся событие. Исполнилось 100 лет со дня рождения крупнейшего физико-теоретика в мировом масштабе, безусловно, Исаака Яковлевича Кузьминовича. Ну, эти стены помнят его здесь, в этом зале, вот прямо здесь. Традиционно происходил семинар Ландау в 11 часов, ну, правда, не по понедельникам, а по четвергам. И начинался он, как вспомнил Борис Владович, на 5 минут позже, для Мигдала, который всегда на 5 минут опаздывал. Но мы тоже начали почти на 5 минут позже по этой старой традиции. Я хочу сказать, что наш институт — это институт такой, то, что называется физикой конденсированной материи, неядерной. Хотя в свое время здесь и занимались ядерными делами. Исаак Яковлевич, основную часть его достижений относится к ядерной физике. Но в нашей области, в области физики низких температур, я об этом именно пару слов скажу, его имя просто широчайшим образом известно. Самое главное его достижение в области физики низких температур — это эффект Кондрашова. В жидкости гелий-3 он предсказал аномалии на кривой плавления гелия-3, которые оказались очень эффективны для получения физики низких температур. И термин, так сказать, эффект Померанчука, как один из самых эффективных способов охлаждения до самых низких температур, порядка миллиградуса, это вот целиком его достижение, он на кончике пера это, так сказать, предсказал. Исаак Яковлевич был, я так считаю, по-видимому, что Ландау считал его среди своих учеников самым выдающимся. Вторым был Мигдал. Так я понимаю. И сам Исаак Яковлевич относился к Льву Давыдовичу, который здесь всегда был, таким величайшим почтением называл его учитель. И, ну, вот я при жизни Ландау, ну, при активной жизни Ландау и Померанчука пару раз выступал вот здесь, на этом семинаре Ландау, когда ходили такие слухи, они до сих пор, что Ландау был очень строгий и особенно не церемонится с докладчиками. Ну, я тогда был молодой, и вот я с тех пор вот вспоминаю, особенно как Померанчук к молодым людям относился. Я вот это замечал, с ним невозможно было поздороваться более почтительно, чем он с тобой здоровался. Мне было совсем мало лет, я, так сказать, перед ним очень почтительно здоровался, но он нагибался еще ниже, чем я, когда это делал. Вот это его отношение к молодым людям. Вот на всю жизнь у меня когда я слышу имя Померанчука, я это вспоминаю, так сказать, с таким благоговением. еще на меня производило впечатление его небритость. Он приходил на семинар чисто выбритый, а уходил уже небритый. У него очень быстро отрастала борода. Это тоже на меня вот из таких юношеских воспоминаний, это вот одно из самых таких. Ну, я хочу сказать, что величайшее почтение к имени Бондарчука имеется во всем мире, среди физиков, особенно физиков-теоретиков. И, так сказать, мы должны снять шляпу перед памятью этого выдающегося человека. Ну, мы начинаем нашу программу. И первый доклад здесь уже написан. Борис Иванович Лёпа. Какой-то подробный доклад о научном наследии Бондарчука.
First, I start from the very beginning that in the years 30 and 35, Погорянчук was a student of Leningrad Physical-Mechanical Institute. And in 1935, she was moving to Kharkov, where Landau was working at that time, and his desire was to learn by to be a student or a scholar of Landau. And Погорянчук, and that time, Landau came to the idea of the formula of the so-called theoretical minimum, which as a result results to the appearance of well-known Landau theoretical groups, Landau Lipschitz theoretical groups of theoretical physics in 10 volumes. At that time it was less. It was in Landau head, it was only 6 volumes, but nothing was almost really. But Погорянчук gave the exams to Landau on these 6 volumes. Nevertheless, that they were not published as a books. And Landau explained later that it was easy. Погорянчук gave the exams in few months only. It was an absolutely record among the people who gave this theoretical minimum. And Landau told later that Погорянчук knew everything. Therefore, it was easy for him to give up all the exams. And just in this time, in 1936, Погорянчук did his first work in collaboration with Landau and Achiezer, the calculation of light by light scattering at high energy. And in that time, it was no common technique. Of course, it was 1936. And it was necessary to work in Dirac technique, and the calculation were extremely complicated. And Landau requires that all the calculation must be performed engaged in radiant day. And as you know, Dirac equation is written not in gauge, is not gauge invariant. And it is expressed in terms of potential.
Наверное, формула какая-то неправильная. Омега на С, наверное, в четвертой степени. Формула у вас С на омега в четвертой, а, наверное, наоборот.
Нет? Это на высоких, это на низких энергиях, омега.
Это не... They found the omega dependence on the energy of the quantum. And A, where they did not succeed to calculate the coefficient A. And there is, unfortunately, I cannot show.
You have to stay on the other side. Вот что это равно стать. Вот сейчас.
Да, но сейчас это последняя страница. Decided to move to Moscow, and Bogarenchuk, his scholar, also moved in Moscow. But Landau was in a short time arrested, and Bogarenchuk cannot find a job in Moscow because he was very close to Landau. And he could find the work only in Weber Institute. Here he did the work about slow neutron scattering in crystals. And then he defended his candidate dissertation on this subject. But it was a problem because the dissertation approach was on the joint meeting of scientific ones of Weber Institute and of the Institute of Physical Properties. It was such a combination. And during the defense of his dissertation, some people from Weber Institute objected. They said that the dissertation about neutrons had nothing to do with Weber problems. But he had a very important support. The head of the cathedra of Marxism Leninism stood up and said that dialectical materialism warns us that all phenomena in nature and in social life are interconnected. Therefore, after such a strong support, Bogarenchuk successfully defended his candidate dissertation. In 1939, Landau was released and Bogarenchuk moved to Leninism Institute. And here he defended the doctor of dissertation. Now I turn to quite another step in the program. Because in 1943, Bogarenchuk started to work on atomic program and mainly on the theory of nuclear reactors. And in that time, Khrushchev was nominated as a head of the German project, but Khrushchev Institute in that time, as we talked later for Bogarenchuk, was about 2,000 people, no more. And it was such a story about which I would like to say. One occasion, I was one time They want to remember Hashem deeply. Very much. He says, no, he made works and cemeteries, but also he was the main person and the development of nuclear reactor theory. And on this memorial meeting, the person was present at the top was Stephen Weiner, director of Oak Ridge National Laboratory. And he said that all the reactor theory was developed by me. After his talk, I did a remark that in politics, the theory of nuclear reactors in Soviet Union was ahead of American theory of nuclear reactors. And I will spend a few minutes for this subject. The first purpose of nuclear reactors was done by Sergeant Harrison and in Soviet forces. And they presented the formula for multiplication coefficient, which is presented here. And in this formula, P is the probability of avoiding the resonance and absorption of neutrons in the course of moderation.
Лучше слышно.
А на экране видно то, что там на экране.
Моя проблема, чтобы на нужную кнопку нажимать.
Encore. Another one.
Derived the formula for resonance absorption. The main idea was that the levels, the neutron levels in heavy nucleus in which proceeds the absorption is very narrow. And therefore, if the neutron has is epithermal, the energy of few electron volts, then in the middle of this resonance level, the row of uranium is absolutely black. And the absorption is 100%. And we introduced the home, which they called the dangerous zone, and which is defined by this form. That means that the D of dangerous zone determines by the requirement that at least and by the requirement it is on the links of the resonance form. And basically this is the idea. You can see that in fact that in the center of resonance line the probe is absolutely personal. And the main the dependence on the radius of law arises from the region of dangerous zone. And so we derived the formula. The area of the road. And the same thing, of course, which что I have never operated on Austin Gudevich American form. And but for the seniors, the serious advantage of Gudevich Gudevich formula is this dependence. Experimentally in that time the levels were unknown and what it was done is by fitting the data for external devices to fit the calculation of this formula, which was done in Soviet Union in many institutes, and to fit it into this formula, which was done in the United States. But this formula has a serious advantage. And the reason is I demonstrate to the only one reason. It is the old temperature equation. Because if you have if you increase the temperature of the robot, then what is active? Doppler effect. Then the whole area under the level is constant. It does not depend on temperature. But the peak is going down and the wing is going up. But in the peak you have up 100% absorption. And the fact that the wings are going up result to temperature dependence. And that was very important because you can, and it was indeed measured, you can predict the temperature dependence on the reactor multiplication coefficient for the reactivity. In 47 appears a component of right monograph. The theory of Newton multiplication systems, reactors, and big volumes, which up to now are in the archive of ITER. But it was Alejandro asked the first directorate to have a possibility to send to all organizations which are involved in the construction of reactors. But he got a negative answer, and the reasons are there that it is not clear for the people in first director if the intelligent service data were used in this book. In fact, it was not, and even the word of plutonium was not used in the book. But nevertheless, for about 40 or 50 years, the book was only in archives and nobody had possibility besides the ITER people to use this book. It was published only in 2002 years. Now I say a few words about in order to finish with classified papers. I said a few words about the condition of a heat conductivity of totally ionized gas at high temperature. This was done by Belistetsky, myself, and Panayanchuk. And also the project of hydrogen bomb. And I will say here a little more. The idea for this project came to came from Bern, who told about this project to Berger in 41. And the idea was the following, that you have a long deuterium tube for deuterium. Deuterium is cheap, and there are possibilities, which was mentioned here. But the theorem you can have without a problem, and the, for the idea of Fermi was to have a tube filled by liquid deuterium, and then at one end of the tube, the beta matter, the mixture of atomic bomb, then small amount of deuterium, and then it was supposed that after the explosion, it will go a short way along the whole tube. And then that means that you can have a non-limited power for such a bomb. And that was, of course, in that time, a very important suggestion. The Deutsch group was performed the calculation, and what was necessary? It was necessary to calculate the bad energy balance, the energy which is produced by nuclear reactors, and the energy which is transferred outside the tube, and the main source of transfer of the loss of energy is the gamma rays. But gamma rays, which are produced at such high temperatures, they check to undergo the constant check. But because the electron spectrum is harder than the gamma spectrum, in each electron, gamma rays increase this energy. Therefore, it may be called the inverse constant effect. And the Deutsch performed with such calculation for energy balance and balance, and he found that the balance is zero, but the accuracy of calculation was about 50%. Kamenchuk promised to the authorities that his group will do the calculation much better, with accuracy about 10%. And it was formed a group headed by Kamenchuk and the mathematician which participated were Kronot and Kantorovich. The former, the latter, he became the Nobel Prize winner on economics. And the result of calculation was negative, but the energy balance is negative, is about minus 20%, and the accuracy was 10%. Therefore, this project was closed, and I believe that the mankind was right.
Thank you.
open box of Tomjanchuk and the first one which I would like to mention is reviewed on Faraday. It is based on very simple idea that the electron in the magnetic field has a curved trajectory. Therefore, since it is a curved trajectory, that means that it is an acceleration. And you know that acceleration results to emission of photons. And that is the simplest idea which could be formulated even at the beginning of 20th century. But nevertheless, until Tomjanchuk, nobody had formulated this. And using this idea, Tomjanchuk calculated first the upper limit of electron energy which were coming from cosmos, and then what upper energy could be the electron on the surface of the Earth because of the Earth magnetic field. That was the first law. The second law is the similar limitation on the energy of electrons in the betatron. And the third application in Landau was more delicate because they see that the net on which the emission of gamma rays in Bremsstrahl is given by this formula. And they increase with energy strongly and also with energy of electrons and also with decreasing is increasing when the energy of gamma increases. Therefore, it means that if at high enough energies and at small enough energy of the photon, this length is much larger than the length, than the distance between atoms. And therefore, it means that you cannot consider the Bremsstrahl on one atom, but you must consider on the whole cell, or the whole matter, a piece of matter. And that result was called later Landau Tomjanchuk. They calculated this in classical limit, and later in doubt succeeded to find the solution for a case of quantum energy when the frequency over quantum is much larger and it's compared with energy of electrons. Now I turn to write another subject which was shortly mentioned by Andrea before, and it was known this work was done by Tomjanchuk in 50s, and it was well known and discovered here by Kapitsa that helium-4 is have a property of superfluid. But helium-4 is a boson particle, and Tomjanchuk considered the case of helium-3, and that is a Fermi particle. For boson particle, what is clear that there is a boson condensation and therefore can be attributed to this phenomenon. For Fermi particle, no such arguments are false. But when I took the remark that if we have a low energy, helium-3 at low energy, then if it in the solid state, then the spins of the atoms, of individual atoms, have two directions. There is almost no interaction between atoms, and the spin is the entropy is simply proportional to two positions of the spin, and therefore the entropy for the cloud atom is equal to 1 over P2. In the case of P2, that is all the crystal case. For the case of liquid, that is quite another situation. The spins of individual atoms are connected with one another, and therefore, since there is no very strong connection, strong interaction of spins, the entropy must go into zero proportional to the temperature. And this is represented on this curve, on this picture. You see, here is the solid state and entropy. Here is the entropy and here is the temperature. The entropy is a constant proportional equal for simplicity to lower two. And this curve corresponds to the liquid state when the entropy is going down when the temperature decreases. And you see that this is more stable because larger entropy, and that means that in liquid, at low temperature in helium 3 must exist the phase transition to the solid state. This can be seen also by looking at Clausius Clapeyron equation. Here is if you get the adiabatic cooling, then on crystal you have such a, here is the Clausius of the Clapeyron equation, here is the entropy of the liquid state, and here is the Boron per unit atom in every difference of liquid minus crystal state. Then, since the entropy, the bosons are of the same order, but the boron for lithium is all, in almost case, is larger than the boron for crystal. Therefore, the denominator is positive in all cases. In the numerator, I have demonstrated that for liquid, it is going to zero at low temperature, but for solid states, it is a constant. Therefore, the dependence of temperature over pressure over temperature has this derivative is negative. That is represented here. And that means that if you increase the pressure, then according to this curve, adiabatic, and increase the pressure by adiabatic volume, then you will go along this curve, and the temperature will go down. And that is just the convergent effect about what Andreev has said. Therefore, at least the main possibility to get to the very low temperature. And this dependence holds up to 1 millikelvin. And therefore, I give the possibility to get very low temperature up to millikelvin by Clapeyron effect. And this way, theoretically predicted by Clapeyron in 50, was experimentally realized by Clapeyron and his collaboration in, but much more, much later, say after 20 or 30 years, and they got the Nobel Prize for this discovery. But in his and their Nobel speeches, they underline the role of Clapeyron in this discovery. Unfortunately, Clapeyron did some hypotheses which were not quite correct. He accounted only the interaction of two atoms, but in fact there are interaction of three atoms, and now the situation is more complicated. There are few phase transitions, but the main idea, that it is possible to reach very low temperature, and you understand that it is very important, because going to very low temperature, you suppress the noise which is in condensed matter. And it is very important for many devices, particularly maybe for quantum computer and so on and so on. Therefore, it will work even more, not now, but even in few or maybe dozens of years. Okay. Now I turn to the main achievements of Kondratyuk in quantum electrodynamics and quantum field theory. First, I would like to mention that Landau first did not like the new achievements in quantum electrodynamics which were done by Feynman, Schrödinger, Dyson in the end of 40s and in the 50s. And Kondratyuk told him, Landau, it is an extremely interesting domain, and it is extremely interesting to investigate. But Landau answer was, to solve the problem of infinities, it is above my abilities. And he refused to work in this field. Then Kondratyuk organized his own seminar, which was perceived initially just in this room. And his seminar was working for about 1 year, and then it was transferred to ITER. And in this seminar were presented the papers of Feynman, Schrödinger, Dyson, and many others on the problem of quantum electrodynamics, the problem of renormalization of mass and charge, and so on and so on. But later, partly by initiative of that group, Landau again joined this work together with Abrikosov and Kolatnikov, and the idea was, the idea of Landau to see the interaction in quantum electrodynamics, introduce the cutoff, which is mentioned here by Landau, and he obtained the formula which is representing the physical charge through the charge defined on the scale of Landau. Now the whole formulation account this idea that the particle constant depends on the scale came from Landau. And that is the formula which expresses. And from this formula it follows that when the number is going to infinity, the physical charge is going to zero. Therefore it means that the theory is non-applicable. In the first paper, Landau and co-workers obtained such a restriction. And I must mention that in the initial version of the paper, the sum here was wrong. And it was found in ITER that this is the wrong side, and we corrected. And now the correct formula looks like this one. And perhaps it was the idea that it is the applicability of the quantum electrodynamics is restricted. But then Landau in Kondratyuk proved that this is general problem for quantum electrodynamics, and the quantum electrodynamics is not separate system theory. Later, Kondratyuk proved that the same situation holds in meson theory. But if in quantum theory electrodynamics, it is a very high energy, then practically not important. In meson theory, the distinction thing just goes to the exponent domain. That means that you gene, therefore, all сочтивость, строгая зрачность, масляный тронный рынок. I need a few papers about maybe not very interesting since my time is almost closed and go to the most important points, the branching production, and maybe I also skip this point and go to polymerization theory. The very known achievement of Pondarenko is the proof that the cross-section of proton on any target is equal at very high energy to the cross-section of antiproton. This is called the Pondarenko theory. And the proof was based on dispersion relation and the supposition that the radius of strong interaction is fixed. Now we know that it's not completely correct, but nevertheless, the most of the theoreticians believe that Pondarenko theorem is correct. Also, just in this time, that was the end of the, it was in the 60s, Pondarenko starting to work on reciprocal theories. And he, in collaboration with people, very deep, about 10 papers on this subject on reciprocity, and particularly they proved the factorization of vector poles, which result, for example, to such a relation. And here I go to the last transparency. Since the relativity did very much in the theory of reciprocals and particularly this theorem, then the particle which determines the cross-section, total cross-section of higher energy, now in the scientific literature is called Pondarenko. The final work was done, which was done in Pondarenko by Pondarenko, and unfortunately was finished after his death, was the calculation of the cross-section in plus and minus an integration in the atoms. And the idea that this cross-section was going as inverse d-square was formulated by Bjorken, but in the paper by Grigor, where I interpret myself, it was proved on basing on the arguments in theory that this suggestion is indeed can be proved in brain of quantum theory. That is the end, and what I would like at the end, that indeed you see that in many domains, many fields of physics, the Pondarenkov influence is up to now. And that is indeed a great physicist which influence the following development of physics. Thank you.
Questions, please?
But which year is this formula? Boris, when did you make this formula?
Sorry?
When was made this formula? What is the year in which
it was finished 2 days before Pondarenko death. And I can make a few words because we were working, Pondarenko, Grigor, but Pondarenko was strictly ill. He had the cancer of esophagus. And that time, the cancer, the tumor, closed the esophagus. And he could eat only through the tube which was put inside. But nevertheless, he worked. And one day, he said to me that he believed that the war is finished. I called, Grybov was in Leningrad. I called Grybov, and Grybov answered that he has doubt in this, in our calculations. Then I said, Pomeranchuk is in very bad shape. Please come immediately. Then he came, and we worked together with Grybov for two or three days. And we succeeded to find how to overcome these problems. We came to Pomeranchuk, it was Sunday evening. And Pomeranchuk asked to Grybov one question. Do you have some doubts in the derivation? Grybov's answer was no. Then Pomeranchuk was silent, and we went away. And he died in the night of Tuesday.
After which year was that?
It was 66. December.
No more questions. I would like to note that Pomeranchuk cooling was first realized in this institute by Yuri Anufriev, and then it was used by Washer to discover superfluidity of liquid helium.
I'm sorry, I'm sorry.
Okay.